All right. Welcome, everybody who's coming in from the waiting room. We'll get started in about 1 minute here. I'm going to take advantage of that minute to plug my computer into charge. But this graphic is the event you're at. So if this is not the event you meant to be at, welcome. You should stay and enjoy it. But if it is the one you meant to be at, I'm very excited for us to have this conversation with our producers and our featured individuals from the Frist Center's segment on 60 Minutes. But give us just a minute and we will begin. Perfect. All right, we are going to get started on this event today. I'm still admitting folks from the waiting room. So if anyone else does decide to join, no worries. I'll keep an eye on participants and make sure that they are able to get in here with us. We're thrilled to be having this conversation today because the opportunity to be featured on 60 Minutes was such a big deal and was so exciting. So to get to reflect on it, on the impact it had, on the way the segment was produced, on the day that we got to spend with a film crew here in our space at the Frist Center where I am now, was really thrilling. And I want us to really get to hear from the people who played a key role in this segment. So we're going to first watch the part of the segment that featured the Frist Center. And then we're going to transition to a few questions and I'll moderate a discussion with our producers, our people who were interviewed from the Frist Center, and our executive or associate director here, Dr. Dave Caudel, who kind of fielded inquiries from people after the fact. Is going to tell us about the impact that this segment had. So welcome everybody, panelists and attendees. Just so you know, this is being recorded. So in case that impacts what you want to ask in a Q&A, if you want to be public with your own diagnosis, any of that, just this will go on the Frist Center YouTube after the fact. All right. So I'm going to play the very beginning of this, the intro, and then I'm going to skip over to the part that really features the Frist Center. So if everyone else would please mute, I'm going to leave mine unmuted so that our screen share here works and you're able to hear it. But we're going to watch the segment.
Autism is a developmental disorder that can affect how the brain processes information. People with autism have a spectrum of abilities and disabilities. Some are unable to speak or care for themselves, while others can live on their own and have unique skills like excellent memory or attention to detail. No matter where they are in the spectrum, many adults with autism have a difficult time finding a job. Even making it past our first interview can be challenging. But that may be starting to change. As we found out, more companies are discovering the potential of people with autism, and some are now actively recruiting for talent on the spectrum.
All right, and we're gonna move closer to the end here. Oh, wow, that is not what I meant to do. Be patient with me for just a moment, guys. There we go. So we're back to our video here. Hopefully you guys can still see it. And I'm trying to
Autism is a developmental disorder that can-
Here we are.
Autistic staff and-
Last year, Vanderbilt University.
All right, so I guess full screen's not going to work with that option. We'll just play it like this.
Autism is a developmental disorder.
And this is a place where we could bring autistic staff and
interns. Last year, Vanderbilt University opened the Frist Center for Autism and Innovation, a groundbreaking research center where scientists and others are developing tools and technology to transform the workplace for people on the autism spectrum.
What subject did you most enjoy in school?
They're creating computer simulated job interviews,
straight ahead,
specially designed driving challenges, and a block design test to help a company assess a potential employee's visual problem solving abilities.
So people have done research on this for a few
years. Maitali Kunda is a computer scientist at the Frist Center.
So this is a wearable eye tracker. Right here and here are two little tiny cameras, and they're actually facing inward, and they're recording your eyes.
The infrared cameras detect where your pupils are pointing.
You can start as soon as I turn the page. So,
okay.
Dan Berger, a data scientist at the center who's on the autism spectrum, volunteered to take the block design test to compare his visual problem-solving abilities with mine.
Great.
For 10 minutes, he assembled a series of increasingly complex block patterns.
There you go.
Yes.
Next, it was my turn. Dan made it look easy. For me, it wasn't.
At this point, my head is hurting. Should it be hurting?
I completed the puzzles, but Dan did them faster and was more efficient. How can you tell? Look at the square on the right of your screen. Dan methodically placed the blocks left to right, line by line. And amazingly, he usually only had to look at the sample pattern once before placing a block.
Why am I not?
I wasn't organized at all. I placed blocks randomly and had to look back and forth 13 times at the sample pattern before figuring out how to place the last block.
My mind is a sieve, essentially. Like, I'm not holding on to any of that information, so I'm constantly having to refer back to the original, whereas Dan, he memorizes it.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
So it's a completely different way of processing information or trying to solve problems.
Yes, yeah, it is.
Maitali Kunda hopes employers might use tests like this to more accurately assess the capabilities of people on the autism spectrum.
You know, you imagine like TSA baggage screening is something that's super visual, or when you're inspecting batteries coming off the line for quality control. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of different jobs that this is relevant for.
In the model, we put things like...
Dan Berger's unique abilities caught the attention of Keivan Stassun, an astrophysics professor at Vanderbilt. His son is on the autism spectrum, and Stassun helped start the Frist Center.
Why did you want Dan here in the center?
I brought him on board with my astrophysics research group originally, because we were dealing with these massive amounts of data from space telescopes, and I needed help from someone who had Dan's unique talents to help us look for patterns in data.
So one of the skills that you have is looking at large amounts of information?
I think my greatest skill is I see things differently from other people.
This is a picture of the seven sisters.
Dan's challenge was to make sense of data from NASA's Kepler telescope. His solution, he built an interactive software program called Filtergraph.
Using Dan's software tool, we were just able to slice and dice the data, spin it around in different ways until something visually popped.
This is a range.
What popped was a breakthrough in astrophysics. Dan's Filtergraph produced a new way of judging the size and age of stars based on how vigorously they flicker in the night sky.
Dan may be too modest to tell you, but he is the inventor of record of this platform, and NASA has licensed it.
NASA is using Filtergraph that you invented.
Yes.
I mean, the brilliance that, Dan, that you have, that's going to become increasingly important. There's only going to be more and more data coming down the road.
And I feel like people who can understand the data, that's going to be more important.
There's a lot of people who are unemployed who are on the spectrum. Do you have any advice for them?
Oh, gosh. I feel like there are a lot of strengths to being on the spectrum. And I think imagination is a huge key trait.
So that's the kind of opportunity that
we found about 30 large companies actively seeking employees on the autism spectrum, including Microsoft, JP Morgan, and Ford. But there are still so many people with autism who are unemployed, and the numbers are growing. In the next decade, researchers at Drexel University estimate as many as 1.1 million Americans with autism will turn 18.
Okay, so we're going to pause the segment there. If you've not seen the full thing, highly recommend watching the entire segment because it was a fantastic summary of the current state of autism at work and how our research is a part of that, but also how there are companies putting it into practice. Also, I apologize for the technical difficulty. Should have known better than to do the fancy thing and embed the YouTube video in my slides. It never does work. Anyway, thankfully, we still got to view that portion of the segment that really heavily features our visual developer, Dan, and our director, Keivan Stassun. There's a brief look at our associate director, Dave, and at several of the researchers affiliated with the Frist Center. And so before we get to the part where we sort of pick their brains, I want to start with the individuals who produce this segment. And I kind of want to pick their brains about why they decided to do this story in the first place, and how they decided that the Frist Center was worth including as they told this story. And so I don't know if Katie was able to join us ultimately, but I do know that Denise is here. So Denise, would you like to introduce yourself any further than what we have here about you, which is that you are a producer and a writer at 60 Minutes, and you've been doing this for a long time and you are really good at it.
You're super sweet. Thank you for having me. And yeah, so I've been with 60 Minutes for 24 years, and the job of a producer at 60 Minutes, the hardest part of the job is to find stories to put on the broadcast. And the question that I always like to ask myself is, does the world need this story? There's so much information out there. We can't take it all in. And those minutes on Sunday night are precious. And so I really like to put the bar high and say, is this a story that 60 Minutes viewers need to know about? Also, I personally need to want to spend 3 or 4 months of my life working on the story. So that's the second equation. So that's just, you know, how we're looking around for stories all the time. And really, stories come from all different places. They can come from conversations, or one story leads to another. I've done several stories on the brain. I'm fascinated by the brain, how we think, how it's different, disease of the brain. I knew very, very little about autism, but I read an article one day about autism at work and companies that were looking for individuals on the spectrum. And it was one of those articles that I just found so fascinating. I knew nothing about it. And so what happens then is we pitched that. Katie and I did some research and got it approved by our executive producer. And then we just started making lots of calls, calling companies and scientists and starting from the ground up, just understanding, okay, what is autism? What do we know about it? How do people see it differently? And trying to formulate it into a story, which a lot of times, you know, a topic is fascinating, but it's hard to find the story, and it's hard to find the elements, people who really want to collaborate on telling that story. And so that's where the hard work comes in, where you're just spending a lot of time educating yourself, because we do stories on different topics all the time. So, and I always say that that's good, because when you're coming into something like this story, not knowing anything about the subject matter, that's a positive thing, because you can really make the story up, you know, as you go along, figure out the strong elements. And so, you know, you one conversation leads to another. We knew we had to find companies who would collaborate with us. And so Ernst & Young and Autonomy Works ended up being the two companies that we chose, but we knew we needed more. We needed some science, some researchers. We also needed a concrete example that would help people understand who don't know anything about autism, or the strengths and the skills that individuals with autism can possess. And so we talked to Keivan and Claire and several people, Maitali, Dave, and scheduled a scouting trip. And when we came out to visit you guys, we just felt like we hit the jackpot. And it was after that visit that we knew we had a story. We knew we could meet that bar in terms of really turning this into a story to help people understand and appreciate what's going on with you know, tapping that potential of so many people and on the spectrum.
Well, and I've got to say, when you reached out to us, we felt like we hit the jackpot, because, you know, we're one of the only places in the world doing autism and employment research. And so the idea that somebody cared to elevate that on a national and even in some ways international level, it's really exciting. And I have to know, were there other places you found doing any type of really similar research, or did the Frist Center stand out to you as the place that was most significantly contributing to this issue in an academic way?
Absolutely. I mean, I think we talked to individual researchers, but when we learned about the Frist Center and spoke to all of you, it was, you know, it was one of those things, as I said, that was like hitting the jackpot with, wow, here's a place where they're bringing together multidisciplinary, you know, researchers and approaching this challenge in different ways. I will say one challenge was that you guys are doing so much and tackling this from so many angles that it was a challenge for us to try to figure out how to boil it down. And you can see in that clip, you know, doing the block test and then talking to Dan about his work with FilterGraph. Those were just, as people at the Frist Center and who know the work you guys do, those are just two of, you know, just a vast array of research and work and compelling individuals that you guys have working there. So that's a lot of the challenge in my job is, okay, you have this wealth of individuals and information, and how do you find the few elements that are really going to hit home for people and become concrete, understandable examples?
Well, and Denise, that is a perfect segue into my next question, because what I want to know is what intentional decisions were made such that this story would ideally connect with the viewer best. I mean, you as the producer have a lot of sort of creative freedom to put this story in front of your audience in the way that you think will be most impactful. So can you think of anything that, any decisions you made either as you filmed, as you edited, as you chose who you're going to put in front of the camera, you know, as you brought Anderson into it to host this segment, what decisions were made to make this impactful?
Oh, there's a million decisions that go into it. And they're all, especially as I said, with this story, it was very challenging because there were so many different strong potential elements. So, you know, the decisions that we're making are mundane decisions in terms of, you know, what time of day, like working with Keivan and with you, Claire, on what buildings are available and who's not on vacation and how can we get all of our equipment from one room to the next in the time that, you know, we had Anderson, how do we have him there just for 8 hours or something? And so you have these, you know, just logistical decisions, but then also the decisions of, you know, for example, Dan, you know, how is Dan willing to participate? What's the best way to showcase his personal story, his strengths? What are the questions that are most important to ask Dan? The visual aspect, you know, some stories at 60 Minutes are just can be mostly an interview, like our political stories, you know, most of it's just an interview with a little bit of footage in between. But this was clearly a story that we needed some show and tell. We needed the viewers to understand. So working with Maitali, and she was very generous with her time, as you all were, to kind of figure out, okay, how can we do this block test? And so deciding, well, at first, okay, what aspect of, you know, she has a lot of different experiments that she was doing. So I was looking at those experiments and deciding, okay, well, the block test can really resonate visually for people. And then right.
You are a visual medium in television. And so I imagine a lot of the decisions you make are based not just on the information, but how do you put it in front of someone so that even if they're not listening, they're seeing it and absorbing it.
So. Exactly. So that's a lot of the challenge. And one thing I wanted to make sure I mention is the only reason a story like this can succeed is when scientists, researchers are willing to spend the time with us. They're willing to explain the science to us, work with us on planning how those visuals can be filmed and resonate with viewers. So, you know, I think that if you all at the Frist Center had said, oh, 60 Minutes is great, but we're really busy with our research and we don't really have time to spend with you on the phone, or Keivan sending us, you know, PowerPoint slides to help us understand FilterGraph and Maitali's working with us on her research, you know, all those hours were so important in us being able to communicate your work. So it's sort of a it comes around full circle, but you really need people to invest. We need people to invest in us as much as we're investing in you. And you guys did that. And I think that's why the story resonated with a lot of people.
Absolutely. And you hit the nail on the head about the nature of the Frist Center, which is that we are all here because we care deeply, oftentimes personally, about autistic adults in the workplace. So of course, we are thrilled for any opportunity to collaborate with someone who is elevating that message. So if you ever want to do part two and cover all the things you missed, we're happy to do the legwork here. But Denise, I have one more question for you before we move on to our next panelist. And this one it might be a little bit of a curveball, but hopefully as a journalist, you'll appreciate it. I noticed in rewatching the segment just today with our Frist Center interns here that the whole time throughout the segment, both the host Anderson Cooper and the people being interviewed are using person first language. So they refer to people on the spectrum as, you know, people with autism, person with autism, instead of using the identity first word autistic. And this is a big conversation in the autism community right now. Is one better? Is it important to use both or to never use one? And I did want to ask you, is there any intentionality in choosing just person first language, especially given the fact that a lot of adults on the spectrum would say that they prefer identity first. And it, you know, communication is your bread and butter. And so I thought surely there was some thinking behind that. And I wanted to ask you about it.
Mm-hmm. There definitely was thinking and it was intentional, but we also knew it wouldn't be perfect. And so what we did is we tried to talk to as many people as we could along the way through our research about, you know, the different perspectives on person first or identity first. And I think at the end of the day, Anderson and Katie and I kind of decided that, I hate to say, but probably the safer way to go was to say, you know, a person with autism as opposed to autistic person, just because it seemed like maybe that was more prevalent and safer. But that was definitely like those are the sorts of things. And with a story like this, you know, there were a number of things, just even starting, what is autism, you know, so how do you describe that in a way that is scientifically accurate, but also, you know, appropriate to the time that we're in and
absolutely.
So,
yeah. And with this story being about, you know, a strengths focused approach to neurodiversity, you're in this mm-hmm. space where you're on a very traditional news outlet talking to a really broad audience who may know nothing about it, but also it's kind of a progressive view that autistic people are an asset to the workplace. So I appreciate the care that y'all took in presenting this issue to the public in a way that they would listen and absorb it. And I just had to wonder if that conversation happened. And you're right that the choice to use person first language is the traditional and oftentimes safer route. And I don't think it's anything that is a huge offense to anyone who feels differently. But anyway, having noticed that, I wanted to ask you about it. So while I could ask you questions for the whole hour, Denise, I would love to transition next to our Frist Center interviewees. So we have got Dan and Keivan both with us, and you guys probably noticed the two of them with this big sit down. You see the photo in the bottom middle of Anderson Cooper sitting across from Dr. Keivan Stassun and Dan Berger. Dan, that big smile on your face, and I love when you laugh in the interview. It's this really human moment of like, oh man, you're asking me to give advice to all the unemployed autistic people out there. And it was, I think it hit you in that moment, the magnitude of this interview, and it definitely hit the whole center after the interview aired. And so, first of all, I want to offer you guys, Dan, if you'd like to go first, the opportunity to say anything else about yourself that you want to add to your little title here on the slide.
Well, I work at Vanderbilt, and I get to go between many different departments of the university and do programming work. So I work in astronomy and the Frist Center, and I work at the Supercomputer Center at Vanderbilt. and I work at Peabody College on a project there. So it was a lot of fun doing the interview. I really enjoyed getting to meet Anderson Cooper. I get asked all the time, what was it like getting to work with Anderson Cooper? And he's just the same person on camera as he is. He's just the same person off camera as he is on camera. He was such a joy to work with.
Yes, well, and I would agree with that assessment. As someone who didn't appear on camera myself in this segment, but who got to spend the day like helping the crew move and helping Anderson figure out where he was headed and, you know, what segment we were doing next of the interviews. Like, he was quite down to earth and friendly with everyone, which is nice. You never know what you're going to get with someone who is a bit of a public persona. So anyway, let's hand off now to Dr. Keivan Stassun. Is there anything else about yourself you want to add before I ask you guys a few questions?
I think the only thing I would add is that a second ago, Claire, you were talking about that moment where Dan was laughing during the interview and what a sort of a human moment that was. And to me, sort of the real magic of seeing the piece come together is that, you know, as a scientist, of course, throughout the whole filming of the episode, I was really worried about and focused on, you know, are the technologies gonna come through? Are people gonna understand what's happening? Is the experiment between, you know, Dan and Anderson gonna work out the way that we think it will? But to see how the piece came together in the end and those moments, you know, those unscripted moments, like Dan's laughing, and I think just kind of the fact that, you know, that I'm not just a scientist, I'm also a parent, and, you know, that what motivates everything that we're doing is this very real human passion that comes from a place of love, right? It's not just the technology, it's not just the widgets, it's this very real human thing, and to me, that was the real magic of the piece, seeing it come together.
I think someone left a comment on the video. What do me and Anderson Cooper have in common? We both have funny laughs.
I love that. Well, and I don't know that I ever would have pointed that out as the one thing that you had in common, but you're not wrong. Okay, thank you so much, Keivan, for adding that in, because I think that hit a lot of us as we watched this, was that this is science, but it's science intended to impact people. And it's intended to impact people on a scale that it is also intended to impact society. And as someone who is autistic myself and works for the Frist Center doing more communications and advocacy than actual like down in the data science, I get to see the impact that your work has when I take it to a company, to an organization, to an individual who didn't know about the strengths of neurodiversity or had no clue that there was even a word for the idea that neurological difference isn't necessarily bad. Like, the idea of neurodiversity was new to them, period. So that is an exciting part of what I do. And it's part of why I think this segment ended up having so many people reach out to us. And we'll ask Dr. Dave Caudel about that in a moment. But I would love to know from Keivan and Dan, you guys got to sit under the bright lights, have your makeup done. Sorry, Keivan, but this picture was too good not to include of them. They brushed powder on their faces so that they didn't shine at all under these enormously bright lights. And so I have to ask, guys, what was it like to be on camera interviewed and to know that, you know, millions of people were going to watch this and scrutinize your words and be curious after the fact? And yes. Yeah, so what were the feelings and thoughts running through your head? Dan, let's start with you.
It is exciting seeing lots of TV people come in. So we had camera people, we had sound people, we had some people from Vanderbilt in the media services department, and who else was there? Denise and Katie.
I know the School of Engineering.
It was a packed day. We had to do it on a Saturday because Anderson Cooper does Anderson Cooper 360 on the weekdays and 60 Minutes on the weekends, and so we had to go there on a Saturday. It was really good timing. We were supposed to do it in January. We're supposed to do it in January of 2020. And then we had Trump's first impeachment.
I was going to say their politics got in the way of our more everyday happenings.
Yes, this is the first Trump impeachment, the quid pro quo over Ukraine impeachment. We haven't gotten to the insurrection yet. So we are fortunate that that wrapped up in time for us to do the interview, and we did the interview before the coronavirus hit. So very good timing, and I'm very glad that we were able to get it in that window.
Absolutely. Well, and I'll say, you know, a month after this was filmed, everybody is working from home trying to figure out if coronavirus is going to be like 2 weeks or 2 years. So you're absolutely right that getting to be there in person without restrictions, without it being, you know, only essential personnel. I mean, this was a community event too for the staff people who have contributed to the Frist Center. And you notice in the background of all of the shots, if you pay attention, that, you know, our people are mingling. We're talking about research. We're talking about, you know, communications and news pieces. We're talking about the special happening being filmed all around us. So it was really neat to have everybody together for that.
Can we talk about the bureau?
Yes, absolutely.
So the day before we were filming, they needed to have some, they wanted to do some videos of me doing basic things before, so that they could show it while Anderson Cooper is giving this, with me in the background. And so they filmed me cooking dinner and then reading a book. And then, the only thing that I had in my kitchen was a can of chicken soup. So I warmed that. And then I was watching TV. And then they filmed me riding a scooter down the street, back and forth.
I forget too, you commute to work that way. So that was really a day in the life. When you've changed the world with some new piece of developed software, I'm sure they'll be pulling back on that B-roll to feature your life.
I'm sorry that it didn't get to air, but the thing was, I didn't have time to clean the apartment. They just, it was all messy, and then they just came in so that I think was the craziest part of the filming process.
Oh, of course, because they're jumping into your real life and you're like, wait a second, I didn't clean anything. This was like any other Saturday in some ways. I mean, there were people wandering through Vanderbilt's campus who were like, what's with all the cameras? And they were getting redirected, like, no, you may not walk through here. And so it was this really bizarre experience in a space that, at least for me, I'd been a student here first, and to see CBS and, you know, every film camera on earth, I'm pretty sure there were like 50 of them. Well, maybe there were more like 6 or 7, but anyway, it felt like all of them. And to see Anderson Cooper walk through was really remarkable. Dr. Stassun, what were your thoughts as that all went on, as you were, you know, walking down the hallway, talking with Anderson Cooper about your research? Did you ever imagine that you'd be in that position? And what was it like to film?
Well, the whole thing was just such an experience. When I'm thinking back to the pictures that you have on the screen right now, when Dan and I were under the bright lights, as you say, and the makeup and everything, you know, I don't remember feeling nervous or like overly pressure. You know, I don't know, when you see the few minutes that eventually are in the piece, and even when you see the pictures like this, you know, you might imagine that it's like, oh, you know, the pressure's on, the lights are on, you're being asked the questions, you know, you're going to say the right thing. The fact is that Denise, you know, we probably, when all was said and done, we probably did 8 hours of footage. and so it in a way, it took some of the pressure off to know that you know, that I could say dumb things for 7 hours and 55 minutes and only have 5 minutes worth that had to be good come out at the end.
So you trusted Denise and Katie to cut this in a way that actually featured your best moments.
Exactly.
Well, and that's, I guess that too links us to the next question I have for you two, and then we'll transition to Dave telling us about the effect on the Frist Center after the fact. But I want to know, Dan, Keivan, do you guys feel like you conveyed what you wanted to? Like the moments that made it on camera were the things that you most wanted the world to know about autism in the workplace and neurodivergent talent?
I think so. When I look at the comments of the video, I see lots of people saying, I'm on the spectrum. I have a family member on the spectrum. I wish that when they grow up, they end up like you. And that is the most heartwarming thing that that I could imagine getting.
I love that. And the positive feedback, you know, feedback isn't always entirely positive, but the amount of positive feedback we got on this was remarkable. Was there anything you wanted to add, Dr. Stassun? I jump back and forth between Keivan and Dr. Stassun because I forget sometimes that as relatable as you are, you have earned your doctorate. I mean, and if you guys don't know this, Dr. Stassun is a renowned astrophysicist, completely aside from his neurodiversity research. So you'll have to look him up in that capacity. But what did you feel like in the end, like you did convey what you set out to impart to the audience or not so much?
You know, honestly, right after, you know, like the very next day, after we did all of the filming, I think I even probably sent some panicked text messages to Denise and Katie saying, I don't think we got all the right stuff. You know, I was really worried that, like, you know, the under the hood techno babble, you know, didn't really come through. I mean, I really cared a lot about the technologies and the inner workings of the technologies. I also was concerned that, you know, that, you know, we maybe didn't get across all of the really like highfalutin research stuff. So if you had asked me like the very next day, I probably would have told you that I was sure that we didn't get everything that we needed to get. Of course, as I said before, the magic of what Denise and experts like her do is that to see how the piece finally came together, what I realized is that they really captured the essence of it, right? And they met the audience halfway, right? The audience didn't care about the under the hood technical stuff. They didn't care about the highfalutin research stuff. They just really wanted to feel something and learn something. And so asking me now, I feel like it did exactly what it needed to do.
I'll just add one more thing.
Go ahead.
I'd say one of the things that they mentioned on camera is that the program that I used, it made it sound like that I used the program to make a discovery of the relationship between the flickering of the star and the amount of gravity on the surface of the star. And what actually happened was there's a grad student who used the program that I wrote and played around with the data, and serendipitously she discovered the relationship between the flickering of the star and the astronomical discovery that was mentioned in the piece. And I don't think that they gave Fabien Bastien enough credit. I just want to say that for the record, I wrote the program. She made the discovery.
Oh, thank you for that clarification, Dan. I can always count on you to point to someone you've collaborated with and say, look at them. And that too is the spirit of the Frist Center. So I really appreciate you calling out their contribution to that discovery. Although I think we can all agree it wouldn't have been possible without your program. So we'll have to call it 50-50. Okay. That's, again, I feel like I could keep asking questions of you two, but I want to have time for Dave to tell us, after this aired, what happened? So let's transition to our next slide. Dave Caudel is the Associate Director of the Frist Center for Autism and Innovation. And what that means for those of you not familiar with our organizational structure is that where Dr. Keivan Stassun is sort of the big man in charge making decisions, Dr. Dave Caudel is in our daily workings. He's the person who is overseeing our staff members, you know, communicating with our researchers and committing his full-time brain to the Frist Center for Autism and Innovation. And Dave, tell us what happened after this piece aired. And if there's anything else you want to add about yourself, please do that as well now.
Yeah, for people who are not familiar with me, I'm also on the autism spectrum myself, as are three of my kids. So like me, folks at the Frist Center, I have a lot of personal reasons why this whole thing matters so much to me. And I'd first like to touch on the last bit that like Keivan was talking about, and that it's just kind of like to echo and amplify what he was saying. You know, we got a lot of people reached out to us because they saw the 60 Minutes piece. And I talked to a lot of people on the spectrum who are neurodiverse. And overall, they loved the piece. Sometimes people would have particular criticisms, but I think for the audience and the fact that they only had like 10, 15 minutes to kind of tell this story, if I could wave a magic wand and change anything about this piece, I wouldn't touch it. I think they crushed it. I think it's absolutely perfect. For somebody who knows little to nothing about autism, this is like the first video I'm gonna send them to. It is a wonderful introduction into what is a very complex subject. And if we were to do this subject justice, we'd have to have like 60 hours worth of like exposition and stuff. Like you can't just yada yada through it, but to give somebody a brief glimpse into what are some of the struggles and some of the gifts that people on the spectrum have, I think it was a beautiful piece. And I'm excited and delighted to have been a part of it. Absolutely. Now to answer your question, I got really, really busy after this piece aired. In fact, I think by about mid-November or so, my calendar had already been filled up for the rest of the year and was already filling up into the January slots. And traditionally in the past, we get a steady influx of people who find out about the center and they reach out to us for help, or they reach out to us because they want to find some way that we can kind of collaborate. A lot of times, but not always, these are people that are more local in the Tennessee area. There was a while there where I would talk to 10 people a day and none of them would be in Tennessee. And it was a delightful problem to have. We made a lot of connections. We got some new projects started. We got some, you know, there's a lot of beneficial things for the Frist Center in elevating it and bringing it up to people's consciousness. A perfect example of that. Last year, we had 5 applicants for our summer internship, and we were able to hire them all. This year, we had 34, and that's way more than we can handle, but these are good problems to have. You know, we have a lot of people that are finding out about us, and there are a lot of connections that we can draw back to the 60 Minutes. And just now, months and months later, has things started to kind of settle back to the normal. So I think the 60 Minutes piece was tremendously valuable for our work and getting the word out there and getting us connected to people. But even if you put all that aside, just the fact that they brought a more nuanced, realistic view of autism to the national consciousness, that alone makes them highly valuable. Everything else is just extra credit.
Well, and Dave, as you talk about who reached out to the Frist Center, my first thought is those everyday people who saw this and they immediately thought like, oh, that's me. Like I am an autistic adult with skills, but for some reason I can't find my place in the workforce. And, you know, the family members who reached out and said, that reminds me of my cousin, my kid, my uncle, you know, and sought our advice. Were there any connections that came out of this that were other companies, organizations, or researchers who saw us for the first time instead of just individuals?
Yeah, absolutely. All of the above. There were research institutions, there were businesses that are looking to hire, there were nonprofit organizations, and as you said, individuals reaching out to us. All of the above found out about us. And we have to keep in mind, a lot of adults on the spectrum, particularly if they're level one, somebody like myself who's verbal and with some masking can somewhat interact and have a job and try to hold a job and try to build and maintain a successful life, a lot of them don't realize that they're on the spectrum. And seeing a piece like this and seeing an echo of themselves on the screen, you know, that's how many of us adults on the spectrum discover that we're on the spectrum, is we find something like that and we go, wow, this really hits close to home. I feel like that. I go through kind of similar. And then we do a little digging and a little research and we start reaching out to people, and it leads to a better discovery, because when we find out what it is that makes us different and we learn about it, we come to a better understanding of ourselves and a better understanding of, you know, when I have a better understanding of why I'm different from most people, not only does that help me understand myself better, but it also helps me understand everybody else better as well. And then I'm better able to connect with society. So it's a tremendous benefit to learn something so important about yourself and come to a deeper understanding.
Yes. Well, and as you say that, it kind of makes me think about, I'll draw in another reference here to, you know, the small screen televisions we watch at home. If anybody has seen the show, Everything's Going to Be Okay on, used to be ABC Family, now Freeform. They have got an autistic actress cast playing an autistic character, which is a big deal. It's really exciting. Her name is Kayla Cromer. She plays a character named Matilda, and she's excellent. But in the production of the show, the actor cast to play her older half brother has realized that he is autistic, like in his personal life, and has been diagnosed. And even though his character still is just someone with ADHD who's the older half brother, that is something personal he figured out by learning about it in the set of a fictional show, but working alongside an autistic actress. And so, I mean, that it reminds me of this fact that anywhere, whether it's literally like in your own job in person, or whether it's that you're seeing it on screen, that you see some of your own experiences reflected and say, you know, maybe I am on the spectrum, or I'm neurodivergent in some other way. And that can be a game changer. And Dave, I love that you have been the person to connect with those individuals who reached out to us, because as a firsthand advocate and as an incredibly, you know, intelligent, you know, individual and communicator, you've got your own PhD in physics just for fun. Which I joke about since you ended up in autism advocacy. But anyway, you've been the perfect ambassador for the Frist Center to connect people to us in a way that they're benefiting from our knowledge and know how to reach us in the future. Wow, and I don't even know where the time's going, but that is all of the questions we've got for you, Dave. You know, once again, you should have your own webinar, but here we are. I wanted to show you guys a few behind the scenes photos that I took, because I am also a photojournalist in my free time, just why not? So I'm gonna flip through some of those pictures, but I wanted to say, if you have any questions for any of our panelists, feel free to put those in the chat as I flip through these pictures, and I will ask some of the panelists in the order I receive them. If you wanna ask anonymously, you can direct message your question to me, to Claire Barnett, and I'll read it without reading your name. But I wanted to show these. So we prepared the Frist Center by inviting everyone who is affiliated with our staff to come in and occupy each of these seats. You know, and I remember working closely with our HOD intern at the time, Alex Lithgow, and she was very excited to just be in the background of some of these shots and to be a part of making it happen. And this is Dan at his everyday workstation, working on some sort of coding project that's way above my head. But the center was full of very excited faces that day. And there were cameras and CBS News equipment everywhere, which, you know, I personally had a little bit of proximity to, having been a White House intern in the photo office and then the office of the Vice President Communications Office. But I think for a lot of us, it was like, whoa, look at all the buttons. Like, what do they even do? And it was really new. And I had never been allowed to get so close to the equipment before. So for all of us, this was really exciting and novel. And then we did the block test. And so I remember this being one of the first shoots we did of the day. You can tell by the natural light in the room that it's earlier in the day. And Anderson Cooper coming in and greeting everybody, even the kids just kind of sitting in the back and saying, you know, I'm glad you're a part of this. Thank you for being here. It was just really kind and excited to meet everybody. And Dan had done the block test and had killed it, as you see in the special. And then Anderson Cooper comes in and is kind of taught how to do it and works through it. So this was really fun to be in the background, because there are about 20 of us behind the cameras watching it happen while just one or two people are on screen. And then this was the other sort of big shoot of the day, aside from some of the B-roll shots taken around the Frist Center where I am now. was, and this is a classroom in the basement of the Science and Engineering Building, where they set up this, the two shot, and then the close-ups of Dan, of Keivan, of Anderson, with all these lights you can see above in the screen where they're featuring Dan's software. And there are cameramen in the back. I'm back there photographing. There are some people sitting in just watching who are a part of Vanderbilt Communications. So it's very exciting. And I believe that's our last slide of photos. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to stop the screen share. It looks like I have at least one thought in the chat. So Jennifer Frist, the namesake of our Frist Center, has a question for Dr. Dave. Dave, can you comment on what potential collaborations new collaborations that have either already begun or you anticipate will begin that have come out of this? So with some other institution, company, or nonprofit?
That is a tricky question to answer. There are,
I know we connected with a lot of local small companies that had some family or personal connection to autism and said, like, I had no clue that in my own coffee shop, car wash in my hometown, I could not only be employing my nephew who's on the spectrum, but some of the other people who work with him and are a part of his community center. Or so I know a lot of our connections like that were small and didn't result as much in partnership as they did in us conveying some best practices and information. But Dave, can you think of any more lasting collaborations that have come out of this?
Well, I'm gonna speak a little bit more on a personal level here. So some of the connections, particularly in California, were very exciting. Some of the companies out there, and not just the companies, but some of the research institutions and some of the research groups and stuff were really exciting. But for me personally, the most important connection I made was with an adult on the spectrum who actually works as a college advisor. He has a PhD in psychology, but he specializes in giving advice and assistance to college students on the spectrum who are struggling through the process of trying to successfully get their degree. The reason he, for me, is the most important connection is I know that that was a real unmet need in society. There's a lot of ASPEs in colleges that struggle in the traditional model, and a lot of them drop out and a lot of them are not able to succeed. And it's just like, you know, I noticed there was a lot of people who needed help with job coaching, but the traditional job coaches who are used to the way most people's minds think and how to best like guide them and stuff, what works well for the masses don't always work well for us. It's one of the things about being wired differently is kind of you need a different rule book sometimes. And so when we found some job coaches that specifically specialize in working with people on the spectrum and understand how we think and how we use language and what sorts of motivations do we need and how do you describe things in just the right way so we can get the help we need to be more successful, that was a huge, huge coup for me as a part of the Frist Center, that we then had access to those resources so we could guide people towards those. And that has blossomed out into some research opportunities and some more collaborations and stuff. But I knew that we were missing something on the college side. We had the College Autism Network and we had some resources. But now, knowing that every time someone reaches out and says, you know, I'm stuck in college and I think I might be dropping out, just the fact that I can go, you should talk to this one guy. He specializes in working with people just like you. Just being able to have that connection and be able to send people, it means all the world of difference, because at its core, we want to be able to help people. And we want to guide them towards the resources to be successful. And if I could wave a magic wand and have whatever I want, I expect that relationship to continue to flourish and kind of mimic like the one that we had with the job coaches. Eventually, we can start figuring out ways to do research and potentially maybe one day build a playbook that we can share with all the universities. This is how you coach people on the spectrum, and this is how you support them and stuff. That's the long-term dream. And we have to have those connections, those boots on the ground of people who are doing it right before we can even begin to dream about building something like that. So that for me, out of the hundreds and hundreds of people I talk to, that's the one that comes to my mind first and foremost.
Well, and in a sense,
I'll just add two. Add two real quick, Claire. One is we were contacted by an insurance group that had not known about the Frist Center, but when they saw the 60 Minutes piece, they said, oh my goodness, you know, the Frist Center is right here in our backyard. This is an insurance group that serves the Southeastern region. And now they've started working with us to get our technologies, our assistive technologies out into clinics and community service providers across the region. And then one other example, far other end of the country, there's a group called the Friendship Foundation in Southern California that's getting ready to create a massive brick and mortar facility to provide vocational services and educational supports for individuals with autism out there. And they saw the 60 Minutes piece and they immediately reached out and said that they wanted to partner in a major organizational way. So when 11 million people see something, you know,
well, it can change the world. And that's exactly what we wanted, which leads me to the question I'm going to pose next. But anyway, thank you there for, because Dave, what you were describing, that partnership, I mean, that is a partnership with a small business. It's one man who's made it his career to coach autistic college students. And it has the potential to blossom into all new fields of research that change the world. But in terms of existing like organizations, Keivan, thank you for filling those in as well. Because I like to see that this has had an impact at multiple different levels of, you know, one person in their own little small business up to thousands of employees in an insurance company. But the question I want to ask, and because there are no others in the chat, I get this, you know, is my question, is for Denise. You have spent, as you said, 24 years in communication and broadcast communication. And for those of us that want to continue to advocate on behalf of autistic people in the workforce, and just on behalf of neurodiversity being accepted and celebrated by society, you know, as a communication specialist, how do you think we best get that message out and ensure that it is truly heard, considered, internalized by the people that we're speaking to? And I guess I ask on behalf of the Frist Center, but also on behalf of anyone and everyone out there who is also committed to making neurodiversity normalized and making it something where, even though we support the disability, we take a strengths-based perspective. So, big question, I guess, but do you have any thoughts on that?
I mean, I guess I would go back to a little bit of what I said before in terms of, and you guys do this, you're so good at communicating what your work is and being generous with your time and patient. And lots of times I think that people forget how important it is to communicate with people who don't know anything about what they're doing, and really getting your message out to a broad range of Americans and people around the world, young, old, different ethnicities, different, you know, institutions. And also I would say, remembering that it's the story that matters. And I think this goes to a little, and it's tricky when things involve science, because you have to find this balance between conveying the important research that you're doing, but also making sure that there's a story in that research, because I think that's what really resonates and sticks with people. And so looking at your messaging that way, I don't know, is that answer your question?
I'm not Absolutely. Sure. No, I'm hearing that continuing to combine the personal connection with the data is a best practice. And also just that we should be intentional about reaching out, not just to people who already know something about neurodiversity, but to those who don't know the first thing about it. Yeah. And to kind of bring them in a way that's like, it's okay that you don't know anything, let's talk about it. Amazing, thank you, Denise. And we don't have time for any other questions for our panelists, but I do see one in the chat that says, is there any internship opportunity for high school teens to do research with your organization? And I was gonna say, let's email Dave. So he, our executive director, associate director, sorry, the job title on Dave changed a while ago and I always get it wrong. But he dropped his email in the chat there, and that's the best person to contact. Thank you all for being here. I'm going to screen share one last time to show you our Autistic Pride Month calendar of events, because if you've missed a past one, you can view the recording on our YouTube page. You just want to search Frist Center for Autism and Innovation on YouTube. And we have one coming up in about a week and a half featuring one of the three openly autistic politicians in the United States. So we're excited to hear from Representative Jessica Benham on April 29th at noon Central. central time, along with a couple of other panelists who I think you will enjoy getting to ask questions of and hear from. So yeah, special thanks again to my panelists. Please visit the Frist Center website or look for us on Instagram at Autism and Innovation if you would like to learn more. And this recording too will be available online after the fact. So that is all. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks. Great to see you, Denise. Bye, everybody.
Take care.